This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Book, Birds from North Borneo. Author, Max Circa Thompson. Year, 1966. Introduction. The major part of this report is an account of birds collected by the expedition of the Bernice P. Bishop Museum of Honolulu, Hawaii, to North Borneo, from June 24, 1962, through January 14, 1963. Most of the time spent in the then British colony was devoted to collecting in lowland habitats. The chief collecting localities were in the vicinity of Quoin Hill on the Semporna Peninsula and near Kalabakan. Approximately 2 weeks were spent in surveying the Tenom area. Additional work was done by the North Borneo Department of Agriculture after my departure, mainly by Antonio D. Garcia. Topic: Acknowledgements. I am indebted to J. L. Gressett of the Entomology Department of the Bishop Museum for providing the opportunity for me to work on the expedition and to examine and report on the material collected. Without the help of the North Borneo Department of Agriculture, the success of our expedition would have been restricted. The entomologist of North Borneo, G.R. Conway, was of great help with our logistic problems, as was the director of the department, Mr. E.J.H. Berwick, and the agronomist of Cocoa Research Station, Ed Wiley Birch. The Bombay Burma Trading Corporation, Limited, provided facilities and transportation at Kalabakan. Mr. Dai Rees of that corporation should be especially mentioned. Others who helped are J. A. Comer, Ronnie Young, Mr. and Mrs. Horace Trawlson, Maureen Wiley Birch, and the resident Tawau, Mr. Peter Edge. The conservator of forests kindly provided the necessary permits for collecting. Authorities of the United States National Museum and the American Museum of Natural History generously permitted me to work at those institutions, using their specimens for comparative studies. Other specimens were borrowed from the Museum of Comparative Zoology, Rijksmuseum van Natuurlijke Historie, British Museum Natural History, and the Yale Peabody Museum. Dr. Alexander Wetmore, Herbert Dignan, and Charles Vary helped with some of the more difficult taxonomic problems. Specimens cited in this report are in the Bernice P. Bishop Museum, the University of Kansas Museum of Natural History, the University of Michigan Museum of Zoology, and the U.S. National Museum. Richard F. Johnston and Robert M. Mengel kindly read the manuscript and made many helpful suggestions. The latter reread it and assisted with the editing. The most recent comprehensive work published previous to my preparation of manuscript for the present account was Smythe's 1960, The Birds of Borneo. This report is a partial result of field work, supported by a grant from the United States Army Medical Research and Development Command, Department of the Army, to the Bernice P. Bishop Museum for research on ectoparasites of vertebrates. The contract numbers were DAMD-49-19362-G47 and G65. The Chapman Fund of the American Museum of Natural History met part of the cost of transporting to and from the United States specimens from North Borneo collected after I left there. Topic: Methods. While collecting at Quoin Hill, we used only guns in taking birds. At an area 12 miles north of Kalabakan, we supplemented the guns with mist nets in the primary forest. This method was excellent for taking rarely seen species. For example, the thrush Zoothera interpris was never seen in the field but was taken several times in mist nets. Another method of collecting was the use of native snares. Such snares were made of heavy nylon string tied to a sapling, held down by a nylon string attached to a treadle. When a bird stepped on the treadle, it tripped the snare, and a loop closed about its feet, hoisting it aloft. To divert large ground birds and mammals into the snare, natives placed brush barriers along the top of a ridge for 1 or 2 miles. Animals were diverted by these barriers until they came to an opening. If they went through, they usually tripped the trap. Pheasants and the large ground cuckoo were taken in this manner. Topic: Notes on Zoogeography. The avifauna of Borneo is of Indo-Malayan affinities. The number of birds endemic to Borneo is relatively small. Most species are shared with the Asian mainland. Only 29 birds are known to be endemic to the island, and 17 of these are montane. The large proportion of montane endemics is not surprising, because Borneo has been connected with the Asian continent in recent geological time. Lowland isolation and differentiation has been less extensive than the montane. The Sunda Shelf, on which Borneo is situated, lies in a shallow sea generally less than 300 feet deep. Beaufort has shown that the Malay Peninsula, Sumatra, and Java were connected until early historic times. Darlington, 1957-488. The endemic species in Borneo are members of four, possibly five, genera that are also endemic. Four of these five genera are montane in distribution. The only endemic for which the geographic history cannot be adequately explained is the monotypic pityriasis gymnocephala. Its affinities seem to be with the cracticity of New Guinea and Australia. The species has been found throughout Borneo. Since pityriasis is endemic to Borneo, it probably was detached from the parent stock at an early period. The Australasian affinities of pityriasis emphasize its zoogeographical peculiarities. A more detailed discussion of this species appears in the annotated list below. Topic: Ecology of the collecting localities. Quoin Hill. At this locality, I recognize five habitat types as follows. Primary forest. We were fortunate to be able to work at Quoin Hill because it had been opened to cultivation of cocoa, Theobroma cacao, for only a few years. Thus, the primary forest here started at the edge of the cocoa research station. This was in marked contrast to areas on the west coast, where one would need to travel many miles inland to find virgin forest. The forest at Quoin Hill was typical tropical rainforest, composed mostly of dipterocarps, Dipterocarpaceae. These comprise an essentially Indo-Malayan family, members of which are so conspicuous that we commonly refer to it as evergreen dipterocarp forest. The lowland forests of Borneo are composed of approximately 3,000 species of trees, Brown, 1955. At Quoin Hill, as in most of the tropical rainforest of Borneo, the forest canopy is stratified in three layers, a distinct and easily recognizable top story and less easily separable middle and lower stories. The top canopy is composed of foliage of giant trees that may tower to heights of 200 feet and have trunks 3 to 7 feet in diameter. The trunk is usually unbranched for 50 to 100 feet, and the whole tree is supported by buttresses jutting out from the main trunk. Some of the most important plants in the tropical rainforest are the strangler figs, Ficus sp. These plants, when in fruit, draw birds in large flocks to feed upon them. Such figs were common about the edges of the research station, and some birds taken from these trees were never taken elsewhere. The birds seemed to wait for a certain degree of ripeness of fruits. On one day the figs were unmolested, and the next day the trees would be swarming with birds. Strangler fig trees reach tremendous size and help form the upper forest canopy. The middle and lower forest canopies are not easily separable, and I shall speak of them together. The trees forming these varied from 10 to 60 feet in height. The ground surface beneath the trees was usually bare, except for leaf litter and dead branches. Sunlight penetrates only where the big trees have been removed, or where the larger trees are otherwise widely spaced. At Quoin Hill, the large trees of species affording lumber of commercial quality had been taken out, modifying somewhat the character of the forest. Such forest actually contained many of the animals characteristic of primary forest, and I refer to it as badly disturbed primary forest. Secondary forest. In some of the areas adjoining the research station, roads had been bulldozed for future expansion and trees had been cut. These areas were starting to grow dense stands of grass and shrubs, and will be jungle in a few years unless cut back. Most of the trees in this area are saplings, with some trees as large as a foot in diameter. Fluviatile waters. There are numerous small streams in the Quoin Hill area, the largest being the Balung River and Apas River. Little work was done along these streams, and only the thrushes of the genus Enicurus and some kingfishers seem to be confined to them. Cocoa plantations. Artificial plantings of cocoa, Theobroma cacao, formed a major habitat type at Quoin Hill and provided a major source of food for birds. Cocoa planters have found it necessary to provide shade with trees of some other species. In some instances, trees from the original primary forest were left standing to provide this shade, but more often exotic trees were planted. Most of the shade trees were of no use to birds, save for providing resting places. Trema orientalis was the most important in providing food for birds. Its fruit was used more by the frugivorous species of birds than that of any other tree in the cocoa plantings. Tree cassava, an exotic, was constantly attended by the nectarineids, or honey creepers. Although the cocoa plantings did not provide much plant material for bird food, they did apparently nourish a horde of insects which the birds fed upon. A drongo cuckoo, Cerniculus lugubri, had 50 caterpillars in its stomach. Healthy cocoa trees were sparsely inhabited by birds, but areas that were obviously infested with insects literally swarmed with birds. Dead shade trees in the cocoa plantings also provided food for woodpeckers, with four species being found utilizing these dead trees. Abaca. The last of the habitat types that I recognized at Quoin Hill was a small grove of abaca, Musa textilis, and wild bananas, Musa sp. This habitat type was frequented by spider hunters, or Arachnothera sp., of the family Nectarineidae. Kalabakan. We worked at three localities in this area, 12 miles north of Kalabakan, Branchin Estate, and Kalabakan. Primary forest. We were fortunate in being able to work on the very edge of the primary forest, 12 miles north of Kalabakan. The composition of the primary forest was much like that at Quoin Hill and will not be discussed further. About a month after we arrived at our forest camp, logging crews moved in and cut the commercial timber near our area. The only immediately noticeable difference in the makeup of the avifauna after destruction of the forest canopy was the appearance of the Drongo dicroris aeneas. This drongo was seen in areas where the trees had been cut, sitting on limbs and darting out after insects. Secondary forest. The area around Kalabakan proper was in secondary forest, which was almost impossible to penetrate. At Kalabakan, Cymbrinus macrorhynchus, Cecropsia striolata, and Macrinus tolosus were taken and I did not see them elsewhere. Kalabakan is situated on the Kalabakan River at the upper tidal limit. The Nipa Mangrove Association, not investigated, lies immediately below Kalabakan. The Branchin Estate area was mostly in secondary forest and was situated on the Branchin River. There were some fairly large areas of grass with water buffalo wallows in them. These grassy areas were favorite haunts of the painted quail, Coturnix chinensis. Tenom. The first locality that we investigated was 5.5 miles southwest of Tenom, approximately 4,000 feet elevation in moss forest. A few days were spent collecting in the area of Tenom itself. Moss forest. The lower altitudinal limit of the moss forest was about 3,600 feet. The trees on top of the mountain were mostly oaks, quercus, and were festooned with ferns, orchids, and other epiphytes. The area had been used as a triangulation station by a survey team, and a small area on top of the mountain had been cleared earlier. At the time of our visit, this small area had grown to secondary vegetation, mostly pandanus. The oaks in the primary forest surrounding this disturbed area were generally about 30 to 50 feet high, and there was little undergrowth in virgin stands. This area was usually swathed in fog from 3 o'clock in the afternoon until 11 o'clock the next morning. One morning of our 14 there was clear. Paddy. The area visited at Tenom itself consisted mostly of old paddy grown to grass and scrub. Forest did occur, but was of secondary nature in the immediate vicinity of Tenom. Siamil Island. This island is about 1 mile in circumference, and the highest point is about 300 feet above sea level. The island has high bluffs on three sides, but slopes gently to the sea on the other. There were patches of forest left on the island, one on the north side and one on the south. The sheer bluffs on the east side of the island were covered with Pandanus sp. The undergrowth of the north forest had been cut, leaving extensive bare areas. The principal undergrowth was rattan. The natives are clearing and planting more of the island to coconuts, and hope eventually to clear it completely. Corindingan Island. This island, about half a mile in circumference and between 10 and 20 feet above sea level at its highest point, was surrounded by extensive coral reefs and sand. The principal vegetation was mangroves. Topic: Ecological affinities of the Avifauna at Quoin Hill. More time was spent at Quoin Hill than at any other locality. 55 of the more common and hence best known birds are listed in Table 1, together with their primary and secondary preferences of habitat. The habitat distribution of the birds shows the amount of secondary utilization of habitats by birds that occurred predominantly in one habitat. Coco was utilized by 6.2% of the birds of the primary forest and 88.8% of birds of the secondary forest. This indicates that coco is an effective substitute for secondary forest for some birds. Of the species of the primary forest, 18.7% occurred also in secondary forest. Thus, three times as many species of primary forest utilized secondary forest as utilized coco. This too might be expected, since secondary forest is of frequent natural occurrence and an ancient feature, while the comparatively simple coco plantings are new and artificial. The Avifauna at Quoin Hill was a mixture of montane, submontane, and lowland species. Smythe's 1957-527 defines four altitudinal areas of distribution: higher montane, montane, submontane, and lowland. Higher montane birds have not been recorded on mountains the summits of which are lower than 5,000 feet, although on higher peaks the actual lower limit of occurrence may be considerably below 5,000 feet. Montane birds have not been recorded on mountains the summits of which are lower than 3,000 feet, although specimens may have been taken below that altitude on higher peaks. Submontane, as defined by Smythe's, is a comprehensive term applied to birds occurring from sea level to an elevation of 5,000 feet, but ordinarily not found away from mountainous country. The lowland birds normally range from sea level to 3,000 feet. Of the 125 species of birds observed at Quoin Hill, 1.6% were montane, 14.4% were submontane, and 84% were lowland species. The distribution of birds 12 miles north of Kalabakan closely resembled that at Quoin Hill, except for the total absence of montane species and an increase of submontane species to 25%. The observation of fewer species, 48, can be attributed to the nearly uniform habitat. The Avifauna in the moss forest 5.5 miles southwest of Tenom was unusual in that 45.4% consisted of lowland species. This locality lies 4,000 feet above sea level, yet only 27.3% of its species were submontane and 27.3% montane. If one looks at these figures from the standpoint of the actual importance of the three groups at this place, however, a different picture emerges. Some of the lowland species were seen only once while I was there, and few were common, while all of the submontane and most of the montane forms were more or less common. Topic: Seasonality of breeding. The breeding season in North Borneo. Birds in the Quoin Hill area of eastern Borneo seem to breed most commonly in June, July, and August. Table 2 lists 34 of the more common species at Quoin Hill for which evidence on breeding was available. The actual evidence was provided by females with active brood patches or active ovaries, males with enlarged testes, birds in juvenile plumage, or birds actively in annual molt. From such data, dates of presumed breeding were extrapolated. In Table 2, the solid black lines indicate dates for which both male and female were in breeding condition. The dotted lines indicate enlarged testes but no evidence of breeding in females. In the bottom line of Table 2, the figures indicate the percentage of the population breeding in any one month. For instance, 2.9% of the birds were breeding in March, but 73% were breeding in June. Rainfall records from the COCO Research Station from April 1959 to December 1964 were available to me. These data, along with the average for each month, are given in Table 3. There appears to be little correlation between rainfall and breeding season at Quoin Hill. A true dry season in the Quoin Hill area does not occur, but monthly rainfall has varied from 0.57 inches to 21.27 inches in a single year. Table 2. Seasonality of common breeding birds at Quoin Hill. Solid lines indicate times of occurrence of known breeding. Dotted lines represent times of presumed breeding. Birds in the moss forest near Tenom appeared to be breeding in January, paralleling the trend found by Vuis, 1950A, for the lowlands of Borneo. Other Bornean observations. Vuis, 1950A, summarized data assembled by Cummins de Reuter on the breeding of birds in the lowland of western Borneo near Pontianak. It appears that the breeding season in that part of Borneo, and indeed in all of western Borneo, Banks, 1950, starts in December and reaches a peak in March. Table 3. Monthly rainfall records, COCO Research Station, Quoin Hill. Gibson Hill, 1952, has questioned Banks, 1950 interpretation of data from the egg collection of V.W. Rives. Gibson Hill has shown that the data collected by Rives covered two widely separated localities, one at Kiao near Kota Belid and the other near Sandakan. The former locality is on the west coast of North Borneo and the latter on the east coast of North Borneo. Gibson Hill points out, and rightly so, that the timing of the rainfall in different parts of Borneo must be taken into account because of the large regional variation. The nesting data from the Rives egg collection are scant, and when used alone, possibly yield a distorted view of the actual breeding season. Rives did no collecting in the Sandakan area between September and March, and in the Kiao area between May and January. Although the breeding data from North Borneo accumulated by both Rives and myself are limited, and records of rainfall are scant, there appears to be a trend toward breeding after the heavy rains have fallen. Seasonality of breeding in tropical birds. Possibly Bornean birds breed mostly in the driest part of the year. If so, this is in contrast with the time of breeding of birds of other tropical areas. Moreau, 1950, found that in the Congo there was no distinct breeding season for most groups of birds, but that in East Africa there was a double breeding season. The peaks coincided with the two rainy seasons. Lack, 1950, found that the Geospizinae of the Galapagos breed only when it rains, and that rainfall causes a flurry of nest building and singing. If the rains stop, then the courtship activities stop until the next rains. Miller, 1963, found that in birds of a western Andean cloud forest, the breeding season was spread over the year, and that breeding could not be correlated with rainfall. Obviously, more study is required on breeding of birds in Borneo before the timing of the annual cycle can be ascertained. Topic: Accounts of species. The English names used in this report follow Smythe's, 1960, where possible. If the bird has not been recorded from Borneo previously, then I have resorted to Delacour's and Myers' Birds of the Philippines, 1946. The taxonomy is that of Smythe's, 1960, except where current American or my own opinion differs and where new evidence has warranted a change. The sequence of families is that of Wetmore, 1960. Two species listed beyond that had not previously been recorded from the island of Borneo are red-footed booby, Sula Sula, and whitehead's thickhead, Pachycephala whiteheadi. Six additional kinds listed beyond had not previously been recorded from North Borneo. They are Chinese egret, Agretta eulophotes, knot, Calidris canutus, ground cuckoo, Carpacyxix radiceus, Stachyrus nigriceps hartley, Finch's bulbul, Kreiniger finchi, and pale blue flycatcher, Muscacapa unicolor. Sula Sula linnaeus, red-footed booby. A captive seen in the Tawau police station was said to have been caught when it landed at night on a police launch anchored off Siamil Island in or near May 1962. The bird was in first year or second year plumage, seemed to be tame, and was thriving on a diet of fish. Identification was made by Alexander Wetmore from a photographic print. This is the first seemingly substantiated record of the species from Borneo, although it probably occurs there regularly. The species breeds on Bankaran Island and on Tubataha Reef in the Sulu Sea, Smythes 1960-113. Fregata aerial, GR. Gray, lesser frigate bird. This conspicuous bird on the waters around Tawau is occasionally seen in Kaui Harbor, but more often along the coast outside the harbor. On September 20th, an estimated 300 to 500 birds circled over the shore northeast of Tawau. Ardea sumatrana sumatrana raffles, dusky gray heron. Specimens 2.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.